Fourmations season continues with the life and work of Oskar Fischingar.
Basically, he was an inventor. He was an engineer, really. He couldn't have ever been Oskar Fischingar, even in his paintings, if he had not had an engineering background.
The longing or the dream to have a visual music, which would be comparable to auditory music, would be flexible, fluid, and so forth, I think is an ancient one, and it's something that people all over the world share. And in that field, Oskar Fischingar is perhaps the first great genius that we can see and appreciate.
He would make that all himself. And this were his light sources here. You wouldn't believe this. These were light sources. Here, look. That's Oskar.
There are many people before who built machinery to project light and so forth, but unfortunately those things are more or less lost. And the film allowed Oskar Fischingar to preserve some of his best work, and that has influenced a whole generation of other people in preparing really beautiful visual music works. Study films are the first series of works that Oskar prepared which are exactly synchronized with sound, with musical sound, and he had the idea that these black and white films could be synchronized with music, which on one hand would make it easier for people to understand them, because everyone hears music and it's an abstract art form, but you don't say, hey, what's that supposed to be? You know, it's not a car horn, it's not a bird, what is this? You just accept it's an oboe or it's a singer. So that abstract quality of music, he thought by making a parallel between the auditory music and his visual music, it would be easier for people to understand the abstraction, the pure abstraction of it.
He had a gramophone, which, you know, was the old type gramophone. We had to wind it up. And he had a record on it, and he would divide that record like you cut a pie slide in 16 partitions. And then he would turn it, and he would... being an engineer, he knew what he was doing. He made a system on that gramophone that when he slumped that down, he could tell that is where that sound is sitting. And he had an enlarging glass. I still see him do it. And then he had a millimeter paper. And he would carry in that millimeter paper just where the sound is. And that was his way of synchronization. When I got to see the study 7 the first time, I had not seen any of the drawings, and I was baffled too. How in the world did he do that? Plaque in a plaque theater, and in those days there were no exit signs, no little lights here or there in a theater. Once the light was turned off, it was pitch black. And here were these light forms dancing in that black space, and everybody wondered how did he do it. Well, the way he did it is, it's actually black charcoal drawings on white paper, and what is being seen on the screen is the negative. It's a reversal.
Oscar had been working on advertising films since the mid-20s as a way of helping to support himself while he did his own personal visual music films. By the time he got around to doing the color Marathi film, he was extremely experienced as a filmmaker. It's maybe his 30th film about, and it turned out to be a masterpiece of advertising art, partly because it is so completely enchanting. It creates a world which you know immediately is impossible, but it's carried out with such brilliant consistency that you're swept along.
the ceiling came down. And people, when we showed it the first time in the theater, and Oskar was hiding, and they were yelling, Fischingar, Fischingar, and he was hiding in the tone booth with Richard Ralphs, who was the Kapellmeister, the dirigent of the music. And but then it happened, they told us, we already were here, they told us that sometimes it happened that people came to the box office and asked, is that cigarette film still running? They wanted to see the cigarette film more than the feature. And it did run a whole year in the capital in Berlin.
With the money that Oscar made off of a film like Maradi cigarette commercial, he was able to do his own abstract film experiments, and the result was Composition in Blue, which is one of his most brilliant films and the first of his films really in which he had total control of everything. Even in the earlier circles, he was just pioneering that color process, but in Composition in Blue, he had complete and exact control of the colors and of the shapes and movements. So it represents his first complete, you might say, visual music film, and one of his most wonderful.
So we started to make Composition in Blue on our own, which meant we did it in the evening or on weekends when our employees were gone. And we loved to do it. We absolutely loved to do it. And there is a little section in that is my work. But you know, wives don't ever get credit.
Thank you.
it was seen by people such as the people at MGM and Paramount, who were very impressed, as they had been, and especially when they came to learn that he was also the person who had done the famous, by that time, Marathi cigarette commercial. So he garnered an important reputation. The companies themselves, Paramount and MGM, were able to take prints of those films to Hollywood and sort of test run them.
And Oscar was sitting in the bathtub, and it was New Year's Eve. And I had the kitchen door open and the bathroom door open, and there was a little hallway. And suddenly comes his voice, "Elfriede, you want to go to Hollywood?" I said, "What kind of a New Year's joke is that?" I said, "Sure, I want to go to Hollywood." "Okay, we can."
Allegretto, the film which Oscar made while he was working for Paramount, is perhaps the most perfect piece of visual music from my point of view. One of the things about auditory music is that it's very complex and very fluid. Ordinarily in an ensemble you have a dozen instruments, sometimes 100 instruments in a big symphony orchestra, each of which have their own texture, their own timbre of sound, and they can do different things. So you have a very complex piece of music, even though there's maybe a simple beat of sort of 4/4 time, but it's still a very complex sound experience. And most visual manifestations don't have that kind of fluidity or complexity, because light is not very easy to manipulate, and you can't show 100 colors at once and get any sort of intelligible thing ordinarily. But in Allegretto, Oscar actually manages to pull that off. When they finally saw his totally abstract piece, decided first of all that they wanted to print it in black and white, because they had decided that the whole feature in which it belonged was going to be in black and white, and therefore it would look funny to have one color segment and not the rest. So they actually printed up a copy in black and white, which was disastrous, because on black and white film, a dark green and a dark red come out as exactly the same color, and if you have the two together, the figure disappears if you have a red figure on a green background. So the whole episode was cut out of the big broadcast of 1937 by Paramount and was never used. And a few years later, through a grant from the Solomon Guggenheim Foundation, Oscar was able to buy it back and actually have it printed in color the way he had originally visualized it, as a pure piece of abstract visual music. So he did get his glorious piece of visual music out of the experience, but it was very painful. And he, after leaving Paramount, he also had an episode at MGM where he made a wonderful film, An Optical Poem, but made not a penny of money off of it because everything was eaten up in production costs of the studio. And he worked at Disney on Fantasia for a year, and again wasn't able to get anything that he really wanted onto the screen, and eventually quit in despair because all of his designs were altered and made to look a little bit realistic and so forth. So the studios were not the answer for Oskar.
He sought desk gold on the American streets. Little did he know what would happen. They wouldn't let him do. I mean, here he was famous, right? He was known as being the wizard of Friedrichstrasse who could do just anything on film. He comes here and they tell him what to do. And there is a storyboard and he hated it. And so he had a heck of a time there, just.
Suddenly he had time on his hands, no money to make a film, but canvas was cheap, and he began doing oil painting. He hit upon the idea of actually recording one oil painting as he painted it, and that became the basis of motion painting. And motion painting really is like the canvases he was doing. That is, it's something that develops in layers and layers.
This was started as motion painting number two. And he could have done it, but he got discouraged. So what he did here is he encased this, and there is still a bell and howl in here. And so whenever he made an exposure here, and there were two big lamps in here, he would make an exposure by closing this up, so it was completely dark in there, and he would pull that, which would release the motor, and would give you the exposure. And then he would use this again and paint again, change it, and shoot it again. That's it. Got it?
I think that one of the things the cinema has been able to do is provide a medium or a vehicle through which visual music, that is a visual equivalent of acoustic music, in which you have different melodic form, you have a flexible, fluid use of light and color and color tones. That's been able to be captured on cinema and is one of the glories of the history of cinema, I think, is the creation of a visual music that we can still appreciate.
Oskar Fischinger's motion painting, considered by many to be his greatest work, will be shown tomorrow afternoon at 1 o'clock.